Welcome to Intermediate Financial Accounting 1, Tutorial 8. In this tutorial, we will look at recognizing revenue on fully profitable long-term construction contracts using the percentage of completion approach. This tutorial has three main learning objectives. The first will be to determine the gross profit of fully profitable long-term construction projects using the percentage of completion approach. The second objective will be to prepare journal entries to recognize revenues, costs, and gross profit under the percentage of completion approach. And finally, to prepare partial balance sheet and income statements to show what the presentation looks like for construction contracts under the percentage of completion approach. This tutorial is based on the Putty Inc. example. Please make sure that you download the file so you can follow along. This tutorial will focus on requirement 1 of the Putty Inc. example, emphasizing how to account for and present the results of fully profitable long-term construction contracts under the percentage of completion approach. Our example contains 3 years of data from 2020 through 2022. And so what we will do is progress through that example year by year. So we will begin with requirement A, where we will determine the gross profit of a fully profitable contract for the year 2020. We begin by reviewing the data as presented. The information is presented in thousands. The data presented shows the cost incurred in each year. Basically, this is a non-cumulative presentation. You'll see that most problems that you encounter will either look like this or the alternate presentation, but will contain this necessary information. We need to know the costs incurred during the year. We need to know the estimated cost to complete. We need to know billings during the year and collections during the year. Now, not all problems you will encounter shows the data as presented on the left. Sometimes you'll see an alternative presentation where the data is given in terms of costs incurred to date, so on a cumulative basis. So what you must be able to do immediately is determine if your data is presented on a non-cumulative basis or on a cumulative basis, because that will help you determine how you would go about figuring out the costs incurred in each year. In the first year, the two sets of data are identical because there are no additional years to accumulate. So in both cases, the costs incurred in the year are $1 million, and the costs incurred to date are $1 million. The same thing with the estimated cost to complete, the billings during the year, and the collections. So with the percentage of completion approach, we begin with the year 2020, and we start with our costs to date. Now, this is important. And our costs to date are $1 million. Yes, our costs incurred during the year are $1 million, but you'll see later why it is more helpful to convert this to a cumulative number. The way this example is constructed is it'll allow us to observe the determination of gross profit and see how we can prepare the journal entries at the same time. So once we know that in the year 2020, our costs are $1 million, we can immediately construct our first journal entry, which is to debit construction in progress. The construction in progress account is a balance sheet account, and you'll see this once we get through the calculation of the gross profit. We'll focus more on the journal entries and how they impact the income statement and balance sheet. We will debit our construction in progress for $1 million and credit our materials, payables, cash, etc. for $1 million. This is to record the construction costs. The next journal entry will be to record the billings during the year. So we're allowed on a construction contract to bill our clients or our customers. And so we would bill our billings and construction account, which is also a balance sheet account. You'll see that this is a balance sheet account and this is a balance sheet account. In fact, so is the payable account and so is the accounts receivable account. All of these are balance sheets accounts. So we will debit our accounts receivable for $750,000 and credit the billings. And this entry is to record the
2020
billings. And by the way, these entries will be applicable for both a percentage of completion and completed contract approaches. So even though we're focusing on the percentage of completion, this set of entries is common to both, and then there is a change later on. Then we can create a journal entry for our cash collections during the years. While the client was billed $750,000, we were able to collect $675,000. So there's a debit to cash and a credit to accounts receivable to record the 2015 collections. The next step in the determination of our gross profit, you'll see that the journal entries have all disappeared now because we're going to focus on determination of the gross profit. Once we have our cost to date, of $1 million, we need to add to that estimated cost to complete of $7 million. And so what I'm doing here is I'm going to put together a list of variables. So notice this as we progress, and you'll see how we can use these variables to calculate the percentage of completion, etc. Once we have the cost to date plus the estimated cost to complete, this will help us calculate our total estimated project costs. So we have a contract here, and if you look at in the data, the contract price is $10 million. And in the first year, we anticipate that in terms of the actual costs incurred in
2020
and the additional cost of $7 million to complete the contract, we think the total cost of the project will be $8 million. What we do immediately after that is we can now calculate the percentage complete. And the percentage complete, which I'm labeling here as D, is simply equal to the cost to date divided by the estimated total cost to complete. So $1 million over $8 million, again, these are in thousands, is 12.5% complete. And that makes sense because 1/8 is 12.5% complete. So in the first year of our 3-year contract, we are 12.5% complete based on the estimate of total costs. Now we can bring in our contract price of $10 million, and we're going to label that item E. And then once we have the percentage complete and the contract price, we can calculate what our revenue to date should be. If we have a $10 million contract and we're
12.5% complete,
then that means that our revenue in the first year should be $1,250,000. The next line isn't really applicable for the first year, but it will come into play in future years. So we will deduct any previously recognized revenue to date, cumulative revenue. That will give us our revenue to recognize in the year. This first number, the revenue recognized to date, is a cumulative number. And then this second number here is recognized in the year. Once we have our revenue to recognize in the year, we deduct our costs during the year. And that's where, if we're given the information on a cumulative basis, we'll have to calculate what the costs incurred in each year are. The first year is not a problem, but it's the second and third years that represents problems for students. But nevertheless, we're told that there's $1 million incurred during the year. We could also have gotten this number from here, but careful because we're using a cumulative number here. So that's why I'm pulling them down from the top. So if we subtract from our revenue of $1,250,000, we subtract $1 million. That should give us gross profit for the year of $250,000. And now once we have our gross profit, we're in a position to start to put together our last journal entry. And you'll may notice right off the bat here that this last journal entry, where we're going to look at recording the gross profit, is applicable only to the percentage of completion approach. So the previous three entries were applicable to both percentage of completion and completed contract. This last one is only for percentage of completion. So our first line item in the entry is to debit the construction in progress for $250,000. That's what we're doing, is we're taking this gross profit and we are actually putting it on the balance sheet as part of our construction in progress. And you'll see how that works out in some T accounts in a couple of minutes. Next, I debit my construction expense account for $1 million. And finally, I credit my construction revenue for the $1,250,000. And you can see where all these numbers are coming from at this point now. So the $1,250,000 is my revenue, the million are my costs, and then the gross profit is $250,000. And if we weren't sure about how to treat this gross profit just yet, well, if we just look at putting a journal entry in for the revenue and the expenses, then the difference is still going to be $250,000 and it's going to be a debit. It's just a matter of remembering where it goes. So now that we have determined how to calculate the gross profit for the first year, we will now look at the journal entries associated with the fully profitable contract in
2020.
This is, represents requirement B. Yes, we have already started preparing some of the journal entries, but now we will see how those journal entries tie into the T accounts and ultimately to the income statement and balance sheet. Here's the complete set of journal entries as we have already completed them. Going back to what we had, you saw a journal entry to debit our construction in progress account. Construction in progress account is a balance sheet account, again, so this will be found on the balance sheet. And our first entry to it is to record the
2020
cost of $1 million. And then If we look at the other item, and you'll notice that these are color-coded as well, so the construction in progress is always going to be blue. If we look down to the other journal entry that had an impact on construction in progress, it came from the gross profit entry. What we're doing is we're putting on the balance sheet in construction in progress both the costs plus the gross profit. And the cost plus gross profit will equal the revenue to date on the contract. Going through our next journal entry, you'll see that we have a debit to accounts receivable. So we've created a T account for accounts receivable. Again, this is a balance sheet account. And we presume that our accounts all start with the beginning balance of zero, by the way. So our first entry is a debit to accounts receivable of $750,000. And then later on, there is also a credit of $675 to accounts receivable. But we'll deal with that in a minute. The other part of this entry up here is the billings on construction. And so that's also $750,000. Again, this is also a balance sheet account. And the billings and construction account is actually a contra account to the construction in progress account. In terms of chart of account structure, we would have the construction in progress and then less the billings account, not unlike accumulated depreciation, because you'll notice here it always has a credit balance, right? So construction or billings on construction will always have a credit balance, and the construction in progress will always have a debit balance. So now that we have determined what the gross profit for
2020
is, and we have prepared journal entries and posted those journal entries to T accounts, we will now look at the construction of a partial balance sheet and income statement. Again, fully profitable contract just for the year
2020.
This is what our balance sheet would look like. Let's do that first. As at December 31st, again, scale in thousands. So we're not worrying about
2021 and 22 yet.
What we have is a balance in our accounts receivable of $75,000. And if you go back and look and see how that has arrived at, there was the $750,000 debit for the billings and a $675,000 in collections. And then the net balance of the construction in progress and the billings. If you go back to the previous slide, you'll see that the construction in progress has a balance of $1,250,000. And then the billings account has a balance of $750,000. And as we said, that the billings is a contra account to the construction in progress account. But what we do on our balance sheet is we report the net of those, just like we would report, to simplify presentation, property, plant, and equipment less accumulated depreciation, and we would report just the net balance. So that's what we're reporting here. And we're reporting it as recognized revenues in excess of billings. Hopefully this makes sense. Our revenues are $1,250,000, and the value in our construction in progress account includes basically the revenue, but we broke the revenue up into the cost plus the profit, plus the gross profit, we'll call that GP. From previous courses, it shouldn't be a surprise that cost plus profit is revenue, because revenue minus cost is gross profit. So we have revenues on our balance sheet in excess of the amounts that we have billed. And so that's why it's reported that way. Because our contract extends beyond 1 year, it is a non-current asset. If we flip over and look at our income statement, you'll see basically that, again, nothing for
2021 and 22.
We have construction revenue of $1,250,000 and construction expenses of $1,000,000, giving us gross profit of $250,000. And that's it for
2020.
So now we will go back to our A requirement to determine the gross profit. We'll now progress on to the year
2021.
So now we add more data. As presented in the data file, we have in
2021
costs incurred during the year of $3.8 million. And at this point, management estimates cost to complete of $2.7 million. Billings were $3 million, and collections during the year were $2.7 million. Here, in terms of cumulative presentation, here's where things change a little bit. Notice that the first year, everything is the same as in
2020
under the non-cumulative presentation. However, in the second year, we show $4.8 million, and that is the result of $1 million plus the $3.8 million
2021.
And then the remaining data is the same after that. So now we can work through our calculation of gross profit. We begin again with the costs to date. not the costs incurred in the year. So that's why if you're presented the data on the non-cumulative basis, you need to convert and come up with the total costs incurred for both years to date, because it's the cumulative amount that will help us determine what the percentage of completion is. So $4.8 million is the cumulative costs incurred to date. The estimated costs to complete in
2021
are now $2.7 million. As you can appreciate, that as time progresses, the estimates on the cost to complete a project become more accurate. Between our costs to date of $4.8 million plus the estimated cost to complete of $2.7 million, the total estimated project costs now are $7.5 million. Last year, the estimated project costs were $8 million. Now it's $7.5 million, and that's because the estimated costs were likely lower in the second year than they were in the first year. And to determine our percentage complete, then we take the $4.8 million in cost to date divide by the $7.5 million, and that gives us 64%. So $4,800 over $7,500 is 64%. Then we bring in our contract price of $10 million. And then if we take our contract price times the percentage of completion, so 64% times $10 million, the revenue to date, or the cumulative revenue, should be $6.4 million. Here is where we deduct our previously recognized revenue to date. So the $1.25 million cumulative revenue in
2020
gets deducted in
2021
to help us determine what the revenue to recognize in
2021
is. And that number is $5,150,000. This is the
2021
revenue, and the $1,250,000 is the
2020
revenue. And when you add those together, that equals the total
2020 through 2021
combined revenue for $6.4 million. Then we proceed to deduct the costs incurred during the year. And so that's our $3.8 million. And so if we take our $5.15 million allowable revenue to recognize minus the costs, that gives us $1.35 million in gross profit for
2021.
And to date, our cumulative gross profit on the contract between both years is $1.6 million. And we can actually confirm that amount. If we take our $6.4 million in revenue to date, that's cumulative revenue to date, minus the
$4.8 million
in costs to date, gives us $1.6 million in gross profit to date. And now we can go back to see how all this information is used to create our next set of journal entries. Again, our debit to construction in progress and credit to materials, payables, etc. for $3.8 million. These are the
2021
construction costs for the costs incurred in
2021,
not the cumulative costs. Then we record our billings. So we're going to credit the billings and debit accounts receivable. Again, remember that the billings is not a revenue account. We are recording revenue differently from the billing. So even though the client is being billed for $3 million, the revenue during the year is actually $5.15 million. Then there are collections of accounts receivable of $2.7 million. And now we can start to record our final journal entry for the revenues, expenses, and gross profit. So as you can see, we can debit our account for $1,350,000, which is the amount of gross profit for the year. Then we can also debit our construction expenses by the $3.8 million, and then the construction revenue of $5.15 million. You don't have to construct the journal entry exactly as it is here in terms of the sequence. You can always go with the revenue first, and then you could do the construction expenses, and then when you take the revenue minus the construction expenses, you'll end up with $1,350,000. However you choose to do it, as long as the journal entry turns out the way it should, you'll be fine. And now we'll take these journal entries and post them to the T accounts and see the impacts on the income statement and balance sheet for
2021.
And so now we will put through our
2021
journal entries into our construction in progress. Recall that we start with a balance of $1.25 million that consists of the
2020
construction costs plus the gross profit in
2020.
And when we combine those together, this gives us the revenue to date in
2020. So in 2021,
we have 3.8 million in construction costs, and then we also add the 1,350,000 in gross profit, which is the difference between the revenue
in 2021 minus the costs in 2021.
And that will give us a revised sum, a cumulative balance in the construction progress of 6.4 million, which is the revenue to date. And remember that the revenue to date is always the cumulative sum of all the costs to date plus the gross profit. Now next comes two journal entries pertaining to the accounts receivable. So we've got our billings, because we're allowed to bill our clients $3 million. So we will debit the receivable and we will credit the construction in progress. And then we'll have a subsequent journal entry for the collections on account receivable. So $2.7 million as a credit to accounts receivable. This leaves us with an ending balance in
2021
of $375,000, and we'll see that on the balance sheet. And then when we take our cumulative billings to date, we had $750,000
in 2020 plus $3 million in 2021.
Gives us $3,750,000 cumulative billings on the construction contract. And now we will proceed to show what
2021
will look like on the income statement and balance sheet.
Starting with the 2021 balance sheet.
Looking back at the previous slide, we had $375,000 in accounts receivable. Then what we have is recognized revenues in excess of billings. We had that in
2020,
but now because there is only 1 year left on the contract, this now becomes a current asset. So when we look at our comparative for
2021 and 22,
you see down here we had $500,000 in recognized revenues in excess of billings in
2020,
and that was considered non-current because the contract had more than 1 year to go. But now, because the contract ends in 2017, that's 1 year. So we now shift our recognized revenues in excess of billings to be current. And that is equal to $2.65 million, which, if you go back to the previous slide, of course, is our $6.4 million in construction in progress minus the $3,750,000 in billings. And then if we look at our income statement for
2021,
you can refer back to the previous slide where we had the journal entries. And this basically shows that we have the construction revenue of $5,150,000, the construction expense, and the gross profit. Now we will go through this one more time
for the year 2022,
beginning with the determination of gross profit. We can go through this one a little bit quicker than we did the other ones. We start with our cost to date of $7.8 million. And remember, the cost to date are cumulative costs, and we had to calculate this. We were presented with the data as it is here in green and presented with the costs in each year. So on a cumulative basis,
we have to take our $1 million from 2020, our $3.8 million from 2021, and $3 million from 2022.
Is cumulative costs of $7.8 million. So that's where this comes from. Because the project is completed in the third year, there are no additional estimated costs to complete. It's possible that this project can continue, and so there will still be costs to complete, and we would keep calculating the percentage of completion each year in the same manner. We just illustrate it usually with 2 or 3 years to make it simpler. So between the cost to date of $7.8 million plus the additional costs of zero to complete the project, this gives us total estimated project costs, and in this case total actual project costs because it's all complete. And if we take 7.8 million divided by 7.8 million, that is 100% complete. And so with a contract price of $10 million, if we multiply 10 million times 100%, the revenue to date should be $10 million. This makes sense because once we complete a contract, all the revenue should be accounted for. We carry over from the previous year. We subtract the previous year's cumulative revenue to date of $6.4 million, not the $5,150,000. You don't do that. We carry over the previous cumulative. And so this means that our revenue in
2022
is $3.6 million. And if you're not sure if you've done something right, this is a good opportunity to double check your work and say, well, hang on a second here. My contract is complete. I should have $10 million in revenue over the 3 years. So if I take $1,250,000
in 2020
plus $5,150,000 in
2021
plus 3.6 million
for the year 2022,
that equals $10 million. So I know I've done this correctly because the amount of revenue I have in each year equals the contract price. As with the previous years, I now need to factor in the cost incurred during that year. So I have $3 million in costs, and that will give me total gross profit in the year of $600,000. Here's the perfect opportunity to check your work. If we want to make sure that we've done the work correctly here, we can figure out what the gross profit should be on the contract in total. The contract price is $10 million. The total costs are $7.8 million because there are no more costs to incur. So $7,800,000. So if we take the contract price minus our costs on the contract, that should give us a profit or a gross profit on the contract of $2,200,000. Well, if I go and add
$250,000 in 2020 plus $1,350,000 in 2021 plus $600,000 in 2022,
that is my total gross profit. And so here is our proof again, just a little bit neater, where we have our
$250,000 in 2020 gross profit plus $1,350,000 in 2021 gross profit, plus $600,000 in 2022 gross profit, for a total of $2,200,000 profit on the contract.
Of course, which is the contract price minus the sum of all the actual construction costs to date. And we've got that check right here. Construction price minus $7.8 million in total construction costs gives us $2.2 million on the contract. And now we can briefly summarize our journal entries. As always, the first journal entry is going to be for the costs. So we have $3 million for costs, so debit the construction in progress. And then we have the second entry that relates to our billings. So we have billings on account, so debit accounts receivable and credit the billings on construction for $6,250,000. Then we have a collection of $6,500,000. And then finally, the recording of our gross profit, which is our construction revenue of $3.6 million, less our construction expenses, $3 million, gives us gross profit of $600,000. And here's where we have our numbers. So we have our revenue and our expenses and our gross profit, and we are complete. And now we'll go over the journal entries and postings to the T account
for 2022.
To recap, notice that our construction in progress, receivables, and billings on construction accounts are all cumulative. We're carrying them over. So for construction in progress, at the end of
2021,
we had a balance of revenues that consisted of the total construction costs for each year plus the gross profit, so $6.4 million. And then in our first journal entry, we add the cost of construction. And then from our last journal entry, we have the profit. So the balance in the construction in progress account is, guess what? The total revenue or the contract price. You know you've done this correctly if after the contract is complete, the balance in your construction in progress equals the contract price. Next, we trace our journal entries to our remaining two accounts, so the accounts receivable and the billings. We bill during the year $6.25 million. So that's why we have a debit to receivables and a credit to the billings. And then finally, a collection of $6.5 million. What this leaves us then is a balance of $10 million for construction in progress, and also a balance of $10 million on the billings on construction account, and then a balance of $125 for our accounts receivable. So now that the contract is completed, we have a new special journal entry that we didn't see before. This is for the final year only, because what we have to do is we have to clear out the billings and CIP. So once the project is complete, you'll notice that the balance in our construction in progress and the balance in the billings are the same. So we have to flush them out. So that's why we have an adjustment, a debit here to the billings and contract, and a credit to the construction in progress account, leaving us with zero for each of those, which means that if the project's complete, these actually won't appear on the balance sheet anymore. So you can guess the only thing we'll have is our outstanding accounts receivable related to the project. There could be other receivables, but this is only what relates to the project. And now our last thing to do here is complete our final requirement, which is to present the partial balance sheet and income statements on our contract
for 2022.
And so here's what we have. On our balance sheet, only an account receivable balance of $125,000. There's nothing here on the recognized revenues in excess of billings because the contract has been fully billed and the construction in progress and the billings accounts have been wiped clean. The only thing left then in
2022
are the journal entries that led to our construction revenue, $3.6 million, costs of $3 million, and GP of $600,000, and this contract is done. So let's wrap up with some key points to remember. First is that the cost data can be presented in one of two ways. So look for the type of data presentation in the questions that you're doing. They can be shown as cost to date, which is a cumulative basis, or costs incurred in each year, so non-cumulative. Next, the percentage of completion approach is required under both IFRS and ASPE unless certain conditions are met under ASPE. Third, the percentage of completion is always calculated as the cumulative cost to date divided by the estimated total costs. So this is why it's important to be aware of how the data is presented. If you're given costs incurred in each year, you have to add them together to get the cumulative cost. If you're given the cost to date, then in each year you'll know what the cumulative costs are. And a good rule of thumb is keep your percentages to two decimal places. Because now you may not think it's a big deal, but when you're dealing with large contracts, potentially in the millions of dollars, two decimal places can result potentially in a material rounding difference. And so what we want to do is limit the materiality, keep your digits to two decimal places at least, so that you can get a fairly accurate answer. Then finally, if we are reporting under IFRS and we cannot reasonably measure the progress on the contract, so it's really hard for us to determine how far along we are, if it can be completed within a reasonable period, or if significant uncertainty exists, then we have to use something called the zero profit method. Now, the method is basically identical to the percentage of completion approach, except that the journal entries are the same, except that the revenues and the costs are equal. So what this does is allows us to match cost to revenues and record revenues that are equal to costs. So instead of, as in the current example, where we in each year have been recording revenues, costs, and gross profit being the result of revenues being higher than costs, here we're just simply recording revenues that are equal to costs and no gross profit. So this concludes tutorial 8 on using the percentage of completion approach to account for fully profitable long-term construction projects.